Are you as dumb as me?
Probably not, because I'm the most smartest. That's why I decided, not them, me, to use Anchor.fm for our podcast. It's been the most easiest way for us to do our thing.
You did.
Also, it's free, and we've established that I'm broke, right? Oh, no? Well, I am. And I bet you are, too, if you're thinking about starting a podcast. I bet you're so broke that you don't even have a custom-built home studio.
With your broke ass.
Doesn't matter, because Anchor FM works right off your phone or your computer. That's right. I know what you're thinking. Crazy Uber Ramblings podcast that you've been mulling around in your head for a little while now. It's possible.
Hey, guys, so where are we going today, guys?
Hey, can we go to that place, Pulaski, Tennessee, where the birthplace of,
No. Could you please exit my vehicle, sir? Thank you.
And something amazing like that will be immediately put out everywhere. Not only the biggies, but places you don't even know exist. Breaker, Overcast, Radio Public, what
the
even are
fuck
those?
Fuck is that?
I don't know. Now, let's talk money. I know that gets your attention. You can make money with no minimum listenership, right? So let's think about Uncle Jimmy Ray.
I love it.
He loves it so much that Crazy Uber Ramblings, he starts paying a monthly subscription, and companies start paying you to talk about their shit. Now you're rolling in it. So are you the smartest and want to use a site that has all you need in one place? Then you should use Anchor.fm. That's Anchor.fm. Come on, dummy. Do it.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of Friends, Facts, and Fiction. As always, this episode is made possible by our local convenience stores, the misappropriation of history, and you. And now to your hosts, Justin Hammonds, Grant Bramlett, and Drew Shelnut.
What's up? What's happening, world? This is a podcast called Friends, Facts, and Fiction. Episode 15, episode 2. Happens to be the last episode of season 2, actually. You know, it's like, we made it through.
Yeah,
we made it, through season 2. Made it through 2020. It was crazy. Also, this episode is entitled Ramesses, King Tut's got a pass, Cleopatra got an ass. And I think I fucked up that rhythm.
Give it one more time. Just run it back.
Ramesses, King Tut got a pass, Cleopatra got an ass.
Boom.
Set it off the first one, you're good to go.
Man, these
As
titles.
The kids would say, rah.
These titles are getting wild. All right. Well, obviously, we're going to be talking about Ramesses the Great and King Tut and Cleopatra, which is the ending of the Egyptian culture. Cleopatra was like the last one.
That's true.
anyway, I'm Justin Hammonds, and I'm looking at Drew Shelnut.
Yeah, that's me sometimes every now and then.
And these are facts. And looking at Grant Bramlett.
That's true. You are.
And for two episodes in a row, we got the homie Sam Capasso back in the stew.
Oh, what's up?
We out here thugging. But yeah, you know, we're back on it for the Egyptian facts, hot facts, signing us out to season 3, which we're going to, you know, do a lot of things. Talk about the after episode. Yeah, probably.
Yeah. Sure.
Whatever.
Yeah, who cares?
Whatever happens. But anyway, my boy Sam.
What's up?
So we never got to really talk about what you actually do, man.
Oh, yeah. I am a barber.
Yeah.
And that is relevant because we didn't really get to it last episode, but barbers are actually a huge part of Egyptian culture.
Yeah.
Basically, like your higher-ups, like your nobles and all that, they would constantly shave their bodies like completely clean. Mm-hmm. And it was like, you know, one, it was an aesthetic thing, and two, it was to help with the spread of like lice and mites and bed bugs and anything else, and like any like those parasites that are going to clean the hair.
Yeah.
So the barber was like a huge part of their culture. I mean, so there's a gentleman named Miramat who he was considered to, he's like the first like famous barber. He was he was doing his thing back in 4000 BC.
Mm-hmm. Damn.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
Yeah, and they were there are evidence and records and artifacts that suggest that, barbering started even 1,000 years before that. So, like, from 5,000 BC, shit. This was, like, a main part of their culture.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah. I think it was, like, it probably, like, went, like, you know, in jobs that happened, it was, like, you know, prostitution was the first job. I think barber was, like, number 3.
Probably, yeah.
Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure. In the top 3.
Yeah.
Yes.
One of, like, the most important jobs that anybody could ever have was being a barber to the pharaoh,
yeah,
and the royal family.
You were very vital.
Yeah.
They kept you alive.
Like, yeah. Because, think about this. Like, they looked at their pharaohs and their royal family as living gods, as embodiments of gods.
Right.
And you're the guy that gets to touch them.
Right.
Like, you actually put your hands on these people. Like,
yeah.
And you got to make them look like a deity.
You got to make them look like a deity.
Like, he's got to be on 10 always.
Yeah.
You know, and
some people can touch him. A lot of people can even make eye contact.
Right. Exactly.
With the pharaoh.
Yeah. And this guy
is like in there.
And, right. You know,
like swimwear, right. Literally.
If he decided he wanted to go Sweeney Todd on him,
there's nothing stopping him from doing that.
Yeah.
There's absolutely nothing stopping that. Like, right. This guy could just off a pharaoh, which is like the most important person in the world at that time. You know what I mean?
Yeah, straight up.
So there's a guy. Now, I'm probably not going to say his name right, and I don't think that smart-sounding British man whose podcast I listened to about this guy knew how to say his name either, because he said it 4 different ways. But Tisepsis, which is so the last part of that name is he was from Memphis. So he's a huge BB King fan.
Yeah, sure.
But then I think it was like Ta means like royal or like of God kind of a thing.
Yeah.
So he was just a regular old dude who like was able to like raise through the ranks through like just his personality and his abilities and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And he became the royal vizier and barber during, I think it was like, roughly like 2500 BC.
Mm. Damn.
Yeah.
Damn. That's right around the time they built the first pyramid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Huh.
Like this guy was so important when he got to like to rise to his station, they the pharaoh gave him permission to marry one of his daughters.
Damn.
Yeah.
That's massively.
Yeah. He had some clout.
Yeah, dude.
Hella clout.
He also, his
knock
tomb,
her up immediately.
Lock that down.
Lock that in, my guy.
Jesus. And even for a time when, I might get this mixed up, but I think when the pharaoh who like brought him on, when he died, there was his descendant, his son, mm-hmm. was too young to rule. So this guy like ran the shit for a minute.
Mm-hmm. That's real.
Yeah, he was the royal vizier. So he was number 2. He did such a good job at what he did. He was given permission to build his tomb like pretty much like right like next door to that guy who hired him. And it was bigger than some of like princes' tombs. It was like it was huge.
That's crazy.
And I mean like nobody else I want to say ever was allowed to have
do that
like
type
that.
Of shit.
No. That is exclusively reserved for royalty, or you know, sometimes like high priests.
Dude was good with a fucking razor, my guy.
Like,
goddamn,
this guy.
Talk about the best haircut in the world.
Yeah, man,
that's like a good fade right
there. Yeah, that razor line is on point.
Seriously, like Tisepsis was considered to be like. Some people say that he might have been like the first like great man, great man, like that's capital real. G. You know what I mean? It's like he
like he's the first OG. He's original.
Yeah,
original.
The first guy who he's not a royal. He wasn't like an aristocrat or anything like that. But then he like just made himself to be the most powerful person in the world.
It's like, hey, what's up? Have you seen me?
Yeah,
come on.
But yeah, no, like they like the Egyptians like had just a very weirdly like fascinating relationship with their hair, man.
Yeah.
Like we're talking about like all the things that they would take with them when they died after you buried them. So every time you would shave the pharaoh, shave a high priest, you saved their hair. Like all you when you shave them from head to toe, they sweep up all that hair and then they put it in a jar. And when you die, they part, you know, when they mummify you, they take all your organs out and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. One of those like little fancy jars is full of all the hair from your entire life.
Whoa.
That's crazy.
Yeah, from every haircut, whoa, every shave, that's every crazy, anything. They that's sweep wild, it all up, put it in a jar, and then you're buried with
it. Well, because it's locks of God.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
What about the toenails? Is that important? Toenail clippings?
Probably. I don't know.
The toenail clippings are important in the Viking lore.
Yeah.
That's true. I mean, made of toenails and shit in Viking lore. Anyway.
Yeah.
You got to go back and listen to the podcast.
I did. That's probably the creation one, right? It was great.
I don't like feet. I didn't like them last little comments. I didn't like them too much.
I mean, like some like Italians who are like really into like witchcraft folklore. They'll burn their hair and their toenails after they cut them because they're like
if
somebody
it's
gets
a part of you,
and if somebody gets a hold of it, they cast a spell on you.
That's super real.
So they just fucking just set it on fire. Well,
that's interesting to hear the depth of barberdom.
Yeah.
Hairstyling, barbershopping,
and the practice
I'm
they
looking
have
for.
Tonsorial arts is the
boom. I knew it was a thing,
right? But no, like, so like they
did that come from also being amateur surgeons and they'd take out the tonsils?
Is that what it was? Absolutely, yeah. And then they'd wear them as earrings.
Okay, cool, very cool.
And the longer your tonsil beads are hanging from your ear, the more powerful you were,
the better the barber you were.
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
Makes good sense.
But yeah, no, when Greece rolled up and like, you know, like stole all of Egypt's shit, they were like, this whole like barbering thing you got's kind of cool. We're gonna go ahead and take that with us too.
We're gonna rock with that.
Yeah. So
who's your best barber? He's coming first.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like the art of cutting hair remained largely unchanged for like thousands of years.
Oh yeah.
Real question? Did they use scissors or some version?
They had shears. Yeah, they had shears okay, pretty early on. I mean, they were like huge, like scary looking things. But I mean, are razors and combs? A straight razor now looks almost identical to a straight razor from 4000 BC.
Yeah.
Like it's the exact same shape.
I just didn't know if that's exclusively what they were doing or if they had like scissors.
I'd be lying if I told you a year, but like they developed shears pretty early on. Mm-hmm.
Definitely. Cool. Without a doubt. Well, that's dope. That's a little bit of a Sam section there on barberdom, or what was it?
The tonsorial arts.
Yeah, my guy. Yes.
Oh, yeah. I thought it was also kind of weird, the tonsil dills. It sounds also kind of like the newest style of body modification.
Wearing tonsils on your ears as earrings?
No. On your tonsils.
Tonsils on
tonsil
your tonsils?
Art.
No.
Bedazzled
wearing
tonsils,
the, wearing
bro,
the tonsil beads on your tonsils.
Yeah. Maybe get some...
I got my tonsils pierced yesterday. Yes.
Nope.
What's it?
Nope.
Go ahead. Don't be scared.
No. Don't be scared. Don't be scared. You can't be scared.
No, we're gonna slide up out of there.
All right.
We're gonna slide up on about it there. We're gonna slide into the song of the day, which is a Drew Shownut selection.
It is mine.
And SODOW.
Yeah, this was a song that came out when I was either my last year in high school or a year or two after. So that time period. So it's been a while. But it always it, no none of that now, hell, it ain't that coup. Come on now.
Anyway,
it reminded me, always reminded me of Egypt. Mm-hmm. Not that I have ever been there, but the sounds of Egypt done by a prog metal band called Between the Buried and Me. The song is called Informal Gluttony.
Mm-hmm.
And this is how it goes. Huh.
Easier to me.
It's peaceful.
Yeah, it's very peaceful, especially at the end. You know,
it's like a very calming Amazon.
The Father of Terror. I really like that band.
Yeah. Father of Terror Wood.
Yeah,
isn't that you?
Yeah, that's me.
You know, it sounds like fucking Berserker mode from like Prince of Persia, the video game.
Oh yeah.
You know what I mean? Like it sounds like when you're just like whooping ass and just like guitar comes out of nowhere. Like, hold on, wait, is this okay?
Oh, it's guitar time.
Those games are so fun.
I kind of thoroughly enjoyed the movie.
I don't remember the movie. I was
Jake Gyllenhaal.
Jake Gyllenhaal.
I was 15 or 16
when it came out.
Because that's a dark dude, you know.
I like my experience.
That part
in the movie.
Was bullshit. I'm talking about the actual movie compared to the video game. It was very similar to how the video game is like viewed. Uh-huh. The way he does the shit that he's doing.
Yeah.
But of course, a white person playing somebody from Africa is always like
it's a little dicey.
That's what
a little
we
dicey.
Doing. That's what we're doing.
Yeah. Well, so I don't know. I saw that.
Brokeback Persia.
Oh God.
Nice.
Yeah, that was good.
Nice.
I don't remember seeing that movie. I remember going to see that movie, but I went with, I was like, I don't know, like 15, 16.
Oh, it's not that memorable.
No, I went with a girl. We like literally made out the whole
thing.
But
yeah.
It was pretty funny.
Good for you.
Yeah, it was awesome. Yeah. But it was extra funny because the only reason I was allowed to go on the state is because it was me and my buddy Ian and this girl and her friend who they had never made each other. So they just had to like sit next to each other while we made out the whole
bro,
time.
Bro, been there, done that.
And they're just
on
like
both sides.
Yeah.
High school vibes.
Yeah. Super fun.
Get the old drop off from the parents.
Yeah.
Wow.
For sure. It's like I kept calling him a meat shield for my dong the whole time. I was like, thanks for being there, buddy.
Jesus.
He's
guys.
Like, thanks a lot. I hate you.
Anyway, great song selection. Go check that song out.
A little different, you know.
Yeah, get your vibes.
A little heavier than normal, other than, you know. What was that song that we had? It was Death Clock.
Yeah, it was
Death Clock. Yeah.
Definitely not as heavy as that, but yeah.
But there though. But,
yeah, it's
in the
though.
Realm. In the realm.
Yeah, they're hanging out the same bar.
Yeah, they're definitely in the same bar for sure. Mm-hmm. Probably the Cobra. Yes. So
we're gonna slide
into these high facts about Ramesses.
Yeah.
The Great.
I'm gonna start it off with Ramesses II, or the Great, who ruled from 1279. To 13 BCE.
Nice.
Known to the Egyptians, though, as Usermatra Setepenra.
Killed that.
Baby. Which means keeper of harmony and balance, strong and right, elect of Ra.
Yeah, Ra was that dude.
It's pretty awesome, you know? Yeah. He was the third pharaoh of the 19th dynasty. Ramesses lived to be 96 years old, had over 200 wives and concubines, 96 sons, and 66 daughters.
The fact that he had that many wives, but not like 400 children is impressive.
My question is, not wrong. I'm just saying,
you got 200 wives, like two with each.
Yeah. Well, were those like surviving children or just kids that he had?
No, that's kids that he had. He outlived most of them.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. You know, I mean, they were super healthy. You know, all the inbreeding.
Yeah.
Really, really high product there.
What was that? I don't think they inbred too much.
Oh, no. Yeah, not at all. No,
not in ancient Egypt?
No. No.
They never were incestual.
Not even once.
No. I don't like the way you're speaking to me right now.
I don't like the way you're looking at me.
I don't like that.
And inferring that they weren't incestual.
Yeah, King Tut didn't have a club foot or a deformed head at all.
No.
Yeah.
No, he didn't.
Was Ramsey the ginger?
Ramsey's?
Yeah.
Not the second.
Mm-hmm. No, the second one? Mm-hmm. One of them was a ginger. That's super weird.
Yeah.
Maybe that's where it spawned from.
They pop up every now and again. Those gingers.
Just out of nowhere.
I know.
Yeah,
but
the soulless
a ginger Egyptian pharaoh. I'm
Anyway,
yeah.
Ramesses was the son of Seti I and Queen Tuya, and accompanied his father on military campaigns in Libya and Palestine at the age of 14.
Damn,
that had been scary.
Yeah.
By the age of 22, Ramesses was leading his own campaigns in Nubia with his own sons, Kwamwaset and Hamun. Here, Winemef, I believe.
That's pretty good.
Sure.
The word looks way more difficult than it sounds, people.
It's almost everyone in the alphabet.
Yeah.
And he was named co-ruler with Seti, his father. Ramesses set about a vast restoration project along with his father at a new palace at Avaris. The Egyptians had an uneasy relationship with the kingdom of the Hittites, obviously. They had run into him before where...
Many times.
Yeah. Sure. Modern-day Asia Minor area.
Yeah.
And under the Hittite king, Sepulhalma I, in about... I murdered that one.
Nailed it.
Yeah. The other two? All right, that's okay.
Sepulhalma?
Yeah, well, essentially, against the Hittite king, they had lost Syria and Canaan out of this. Seti won... recaptured the most coveted center of Kadesh in Syria. But it had also been taken back from him by the Hittite king Muwatabi II, which I mentioned in the first episode. So after the death of Seti I in 1290 BCE, Ramses assumed the throne and at once began military campaigns to restore the borders of Egypt, ensure trade routes, and take back all the shit the Hittites had just taken from him.
That's gangster as fuck.
Yeah, you know, try to. In the second year of his reign, Ramses defeated the Sea Peoples.
The Sea Peoples, the Nile Delta. Okay, see,
we talked about this. Let's
talk about
Aquaman and motherfucking the Atlanteans.
Look, so Jason Momoa and the Atlanteans.
Yeah, they were fighting the Egyptian
people. You're
not people.
Throwing enough respect on the Atlantean people, and I'm sensing that.
No, they're all in Atlanta now.
Oh, word. Yeah. There's something special about those Migos boys.
I'm telling you. Culture Christ 3 is coming soon.
Oh, God. I cannot wait.
Let's go. Bad and bougie.
According to Ramsey's account, these were a people known as the Sherden, who were allies of the Hittites. Ramses laid a trap for them by placing a small naval contingent at the mouth of the Nile to lure the Sheridan warships in.
And a bunch of nets.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, because they're underwater. They're in the water, so they see people.
Once they had engaged, he launched his full attack from both sides, and he sunk all their ships,
which was
pretty great. The only surviving Sheridan, he just put in his own army. He was just like, yeah, you guys get to... You know, and some of them that were badasses, he put in the elite bodyguard,
which is pretty cool.
And by put them into, they were forced into these positions.
Yeah, swim and
get away.
Also makes me think about how truly cocky this guy was.
Oh, yeah, big time.
You know, like these are captured in war, mm-hmm. so they clearly are not big fans of him. And he's like, yeah, you guys are going to be my bodyguards.
Bugatti guards?
Yeah, that's how he talks. If anybody,
the Bugatti guards.
Hey, boys, you just beat me on my Bobby barge. Hey, everybody, I'm Ramses. I'm Ramses. I'm DeParo. I'm DeParo. It's really nice to meet you, Josh. So, I'm really looking forward to working with you. And I think it would be great Bobby barge.
So, is it a test to how cocky he was, but also how much power he had? You think about that, you know? Because if you lose to him, then who else is the dude?
I mean, he talked like that and was able to hold a kingdom together for 100 years.
Yeah. That's what's truly crazy.
Yeah. You know? And,
I mean, that's the real mark of them having no incest at all. Yeah. The clear vernacular he used.
Wow, buddy, I really can't wait to run the tandem.
Oh, thank you so much.
I just imagine with a big droopy McPoodle cheeks, and he's just got this little belly. He's like, hey, Dodge, are you ready to go to war? I can't wait, we're going to beat up all the D people. We're going to beat the D people and beat them up Bobby Barnes. Yeah.
See, this is pure art right here. We took an honest mistake and made a whole comedic set.
So good.
It's great. Oh, man.
And back to these hot facts.
Well, the last hot fact on them is that there are no hot facts on where they're from. No one knows.
Where
so the sea people are from? The sea people, they just don't, they really don't know where they're from.
Because they became Egyptians probably, right?
As everyone else that kind of showed up, they just kind of acclimated to the region. Like,
as illustrated in the documentary, Prince of Egypt.
Prince of Egypt.
Yes. Thank you, Sam.
Yep.
The documentary.
At some point prior to the year 1275 BCE, he, being Ramses, mm-hmm. began the construction of what we brought up in the first episode, his great city per Ramses, or House of Ramses.
Because everything was Ramses, huh?
Oh, yeah, he had to stamp it. Yeah. Like, stamp it.
Stamp it. I'm going to build a daddy. I'm going to put my damn on it.
Because flip-flops was Ramses, shirts was Ramses, fucking carriages was Ramses,
it's
buildings
it's
were Ramses. Ramses, right? Ramses. another thing
for Ramesses.
Ramesses Museum.
Yeah, that's his museum. Yeah, it's real shit. Just Ramesses.
Yeah. Those are hot facts for real.
Are you really?
Yeah, we're not making this shit up.
His museums that he built, he called them Ramesses.
Essentially, everything that he had to name.
I
was Ramesses.
I think he did talk like that. I'm going to build a big town with all my dump in it, and I'm going to call it Ramesses.
It's my stuff.
It's my dump. I'm going to build it, and it look my tough, and you pay for my dump too.
The spirit of Ramesses is after us.
Yeah. He's just going to come waddling in here and start flipping over tables. You do a footy footy.
You're going to watch out. Stanley's over here.
Jesus Christ. The Ramesses was actually a pleasure palace and a military compound.
That sounds about
right.
So, that sounds about right.
Military.
But my lady, did go live in the I can't do this all day.
You have to. You got to do the rest of the episode.
I don't know. My lady
did my military. I'm just going to give the doc to you, and you're just going to read it.
Just read the whole thing.
That's great. I love the whole thing.
So it's a pleasure house and a military fort, I guess, at the same time. That makes sense.
Well, that's just good economics.
And actually,
it's like keep the soldiers happy.
Utilize space.
Yeah.
Some scholars actually suggest that the Ramesses was actually founded and it was started by his dad.
His dad
was actually the one who a lot of, you know, them believe, and they are scholars, so they know more than the rest of us. So
yeah, tell you
we
what.
Are to believe in tell what they're saying and such. but, you know, we'll never know. In late 1275 BCE, Ramesses prepared his army to march on Kadesh and waited only for the omens to be auspicious. And word from his spies in Syria as to the enemy's strengths and position. So he just wanted to get back, you know, spy stuff. And he had to talk to the soothsayers or whatever of the time to, you know, see his omens or, you know, whatever for the. All that religious
stuff. Talk to the oracles, if you will.
Yeah, the oracle. That's the word.
Yeah.
Except for they weren't oracles then.
This is true, but something like that.
I believe one of them sounded like Martin Short. And the other one sounded like Steve Martin.
Yes.
One was tall and skinny. That one was short and fat.
Yeah.
They also had sticks that would turn into snakes sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the armies marched for 2 months before reaching a place where he felt confident in arranging his army into a battle formation. Yep. And waited with his Amun division, which he had Amun, Ptah, Ra, and Set. Divisions named after the gods.
That's really cool.
And so he had to wait on his Amun division with his sons for the others to catch up. At this time, two Hittite spies were captured who, under torture, gave up the location of the Hittite army and said, "You motherfucker."
What? No, sorry. Ramesses' torture is just make him smell his armpits. Tell me where to do it. I'm going to make you trouble, but you can't.
Oh my god! I was not ready for that. Left turn. Right.
Anyway, he tortured them, and they said that it was nowhere near the city. Reassured, Ramesses abandoned his plans for an immediate strike and gave orders for his division to encamp and wait for the rest of the army to arrive. The Hittite army, however, was actually less than a mile away. And the two spies had been purposefully sent.
That's cunning.
As Ramesses was pitching camp, the Hittites roared out from behind the walls of Kadesh and crushed his ass, you know?
It's like a first evidence of like a coup.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And so the whole politics of Egypt created politics for like what we experience now, pretty much. Like the backdoor deals and like, oh, let's spy on this person to fuck over this person. That's basically the first attempt of this and the attempt of an ambush, I believe, in military history.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And I did realize something. Ramesses is the pharaoh in Prince of Egypt.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This Prince of Egypt reference. Anyway.
Connect to that.
Well, as Ramesses was starting to get his ass beat, obviously,
the
Ptah division showed up and kind of turned the tide a little bit for him. Nice. And he started to drive the Hittites towards the Orontes River, killing many of them while driving the others to drowning as they tried to escape.
Yeah, that sucks.
So everything was, you know, coming against them as they were kamikazed upon, apparently. And then the Ptah showed up.
Yeah.
And
helped them out.
Helped them out quite a bit. So pushing these guys back into the river and drowning most of them, he claimed, victory over the battle. Well, they claimed, victory over it as well. So at the end of the day, they came to a peace treaty.
Yeah, it was that cool time where they were like, "Oh, bro, we won, but like you won too. Like we cool, cause like you beat us when we try to do something real dope, but then you beat us. So like we cool though. I think we cool.
Yeah.
They did.
Yeah. After the whole Battle of Kadesh thing goes on for a while. There's a lot of shit that goes into that, but the long and short of all of that information is that what we just said. One ambushed the other came back and started whooping the other one, and they came to a standstill at the end, both claiming victory. And after that, not much really happened until your next dynasties.
It's kind of like a classic two friends get into a fist fight, and afterwards it's like, let's go get a beer, bro.
Yeah.
I mean, fuck it.
Yep.
Like what Drew's going to do to me if I keep talking in that voice.
That really tickled him.
Anyway, so I'm going to go over a couple buildings and things that people or historians believe to have been built by Ramesses. So there is a vast tomb complex known as the Ramesseum at Thebes.
Yeah.
The temples at Abu Simbel, the Hall of Karnak, the complex at Abydos, and literally hundreds of other buildings, monuments, temples, and, other things. So, yeah, there was a Ramesseum.
Yes.
Yeah. And the reason why he built that Ramesseum was because of all those children that I mentioned at the beginning. Uh-huh. He had to build it. The reason why it was so big is because
he had to
house all of those children.
Yeah. So I had two dirty tits. I got to put them somewhere. I put them with my tuff. They're my tuff, too. So I go away, look at my tuff, and I look at my kids, and I go home. Yeah.
It's a huge tomb complex that has been unearthed as of this year or last year, 2019. So not this year, year before. Yeah. Last.
A lot of historians consider Ramesses' reign the pinnacle of Egyptian art and culture. And the famous tomb of Nefertiti, Nefertiti. Mm-hmm. With its wall painting is cited, because of her, influence, had the wall paintings and such, is cited as clever evidence of the truth and of this claim. Nefertiti was Ramesses' first wife and his favorite queen. Of course she was. Many depictions of Nefertiti appear on temple walls and its statuary throughout his reign, even though she seems to have died fairly early in the marriage, perhaps in childbirth.
Probably.
Yeah.
Maybe 50 kids he pumped into her.
Yeah. And her tomb, even though discovered looted, was a work of art and construction and decoration as well, was just like pimped out, if you will.
Man, imagine it was all in there before people,
Yeah,
that would be. Before people fucked it up? Could have been some,
explorers, Justin.
Explorers, yes. Yeah. Discoverers, if you will.
Yeah.
The Columbuses of the world.
Treasure hunters, not grave robbers.
So Nicolas Cage. Yes.
But
national treasure.
Probably also a pedophile at the same time.
Yeah, who knows? Such is life.
I just
assume any grave robber is also a kitty diddler. Like if you're that terrible, like, well, let's just really go for it,
Why not?
So after Nefertiti, Ramesses elevated his secondary wife. Here's the secondary wife stuff again, or second, whatever they want to call it. Eset Nefret to the position of queen, and after her death, his daughters became his consorts.
Oh, I don't like that.
So yeah, no incest.
No incest.
Left
none.
Turn.
Which did? I mean, she's my daughter, but she's pretty hot. I'm hot. Her mom was hot. And it just wouldn't make sense. Like, I just tell her, hey, come here, Ivanka. You're just so hot.
Well, although Nefertiti was still dead, he was still super enthralled with her and continued to put her on the, engraved on walls and paintings and stuff, like I mentioned before. But he always treated the children of the wives with equal regard and respect. Nefertiti was the mother of his sons, Ramesses, and Amun-Hirwenhef, and Eset Nefret, God, I almost got the last one again. Just didn't, though. The just mother like, of Kawemset. And yet all three were treated the same.
Huh. That's cool.
Look at that.
You know, that's nice.
Also, just do what that British lady does and say it real fast and just straight ahead and just pretend like that's the right
thing. Oh, that was the Usur Matra Pinra Fenra Fenra one.
Yeah.
That one was different.
Yeah. Just she didn't know how to say that word either, but she fucking just didn't struggle over it. She's just like, confident.
That's what confidence.
So another thing is, another big thing is that, like, people, the biggest thing that people think of when they think of Ramses is, like, the biblical reference and how he enslaved Moses and, you know, and the book of Exodus and stuff. There is no evidence to claim, you know, to support this claim at all. So, well,
are you telling me the greatest selling book
in
the history of mankind isn't enough evidence for you? Are you telling me the word of our Lord and Savior is not enough finger quotes evidence for you?
Evidence.
Well, a lot of the reason behind this is because Ramses was one of them dudes who recorded everything. He might even recorded his farts.
Yeah, well.
I'm telling you what, he didn't record nothing about none of that.
We don't like to write our sins down now, do we?
So he created audio equipment?
Yes.
Anyway. Funny. Go record. Anyway.
Okay. So the reign of Ramses the Great has become somewhat controversial over the last century, with some scholars claiming he was more of a showman and a propagandist than an effective king, and others arguing the opposite. Obviously, others are going to argue the opposite if there's an argument.
Yeah. Right. That's how arguments work.
That's how that works. It's kind of weird. The records of his reign, however, both the written and the physical evidence of the temples and monuments argue a very stable and prosperous reign. He was one of the only few rulers to live and rule long enough to take part in two Hebsed festivals, which were held every 30 years to rejuvenate the pharaoh.
Oh, I bet they thought that was working really well.
Yeah.
Just in case.
They're like, oh, we got two in one. Hell yeah.
There you go.
He secured the country's borders, increased its wealth, and widened its scope of trade, and he boasted of his accomplishments in his inscriptions and monuments. He definitely boasted in his inscriptions.
Yeah.
He put himself like, every Ramesses.
I died, 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 I
leaving your legacy. Because, like, the next ruler would probably destroy your name. So you put it every fucking letter.
Oh, yeah. Every time. Everybody going to know how Dr. Miami. Yeah,
exactly. They'll miss at least one or two things. You know what I mean? If you put it on thousands of shit.
So to finalize this guy, Ramses the Great's mummy shows that he stood over 6 feet in height.
God damn.
Yeah. Well, yeah, especially then.
That's huge. That's a big Egyptian. Yeah. Just like Egyptians are not tall people.
Yeah.
That's a big Egyptian.
With a strong jaw, thick nose, and thick lips. Yeah, so he was, you know.
Ramses the Great.
That was the body double that he left in there. He was actually only 4'3", and he was shaped very similarly to an Oompa Loompa.
It's a stand-in.
Scholars believe he probably died of old age or heart failure. I mean, he had dental problems, severe arthritis, and hardened arteries. So
he was in his 90s.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
That shit
pretty,
is
pretty natural.
Yeah, that's impressive today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm pretty certain I won't make it to my 90s.
God. I told somebody about your end-of-life plan, and I'm really excited about it.
Yeah.
It's going to be sweet.
All right.
Yeah.
Do you know about his end-of-life plan?
Are you going to respond to this? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
I've known Grant for
almost
12 years. That's
I assume. It was like the first thing he told me when I met him.
We've talked about end-of-life plans.
Yeah. Do you want to tell the people?
No. Okay. I will like to talk about King Tut, though.
Boom, bang, bang.
Smooth as glass.
I'm telling you.
I'm so good with this. I'm telling you, man.
That shit was like, yeah.
So, Tutankhamun is the most famous and instantly recognizable pharaoh in the modern world, as we all know.
Yes, for sure.
He had a big butt, right?
He did have a big old butt.
Mm-hmm. Big old butt. Mm-hmm. How big was it? Or what color was it? You know? Lots of stuff about King Tut's butt.
I would like to know.
In the children's jumping rope games.
Mm-hmm. What is that?
King Tut had a big old butt.
I didn't do that.
King Tut had a big butt.
That might be a
what color
thing.
Was it? No, nothing.
No, it's not.
Maybe it's a South thing. Who knows?
All right,
probably.
And yeah,
I thought you were just gonna talk about his butt for half an hour.
And we're off into these hot facts about
His golden sarcophagus is now a symbol almost synonymous with Egypt. Yeah. His name means living image of the god Amun. Mm-hmm. He was born in the year 11 of the reign of Pharaoh Amenhotep IV.
It's a cool name.
Mm-hmm. It was like around 1345 BCE and died, some claim mysteriously, in 1327 BCE at the age of 17 or 18.
He was young as hell.
Wasn't and so mysterious, deformed. Though, after they kind of like figure out what he looked like, though. Seems like the guy was just riddled with health problems.
Yeah, for sure.
He was.
Because they didn't have incest.
No, no incest. It was all natural. Yep. What did you say his name meant again?
I don't remember.
The light of
the living
God.
Living image of the god Amun.
That all you got that all from Tut?
Yeah, oh yeah.
Tutankhamun, bro. Tutankhamun was his name.
Seems still like a lot to get from that short of a name.
Tut is the shortening of Tutankhamun.
Mm-hmm. I get
that. Oh, okay. I didn't know if you got that part.
I'm saying it's a lot. All right, sorry.
That's a whole lot.
I digress. Like I said, I'm only here to derail the podcast.
Yeah, you're doing a great job. Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
No, but really, honestly, he's this celebrity solely because of in 1922 of our era when Howard Carter discovered his almost fully intact tomb in the Valley of the Kings. Mm-hmm. He's just total circumstantial. That King Tut's so massive just because no grave robbers managed to get a hold of it before Egyptologists got a hold of it.
And it was very well preserved and beautiful, pristine.
Yeah, they exactly. Found it. Yeah. He's recognized as an important pharaoh who returned order to a land left in chaos by his father's political religious reforms and who would no doubt have made further impressive contributions to Egypt's history, if not for his early death.
No.
His wife, though, was Nefertiti.
Mm-hmm.
Who was almost equally as famous and recognizable as her stepson.
Yeah.
Tutankhamun's mother was the lady Kia, one of Amenhotep's lesser wives, and was not Nefertiti. It had been suggested that Tutankhamun was the son of Amenhotep III and his queen, Tai.
I guess.
Tai, yeah.
But most scholars reject this theory.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, it's just so bad. It's hard to present some of this information because they're just like, so we believe that was this his person, and then it was his dad, and it was his brother's dad.
Could be this guy. Or else they're just guessing. They're just saying
because
stuff.
It's like, well, that was his cousin, but it also could be his uncle, but it might be his brother, too,
but that
banged his auntie.
You know, guys?
That made him, but then it could have been his cousin's sister.
I'm thinking there might have been a little incest.
Maybe a little bit.
Finally convinced you?
Maybe just a little bit.
A little bit. Might have been that scoosh.
But he came to the throne at the age of 8 or 9, and miniature symbols of royalties like the crook and flail and royal staff were found in his tomb, and it seems likely he played with these as a young child as he's being groomed for future rule.
Mm-hmm. That's cute. I like that.
That's nice. Yeah. Just put some toys in there.
None like childhood.
He's all broke. He's all broke and beat down. Just give him some toys in the afterlife.
A historian, Hawass, writes, a number of these items were inscribed with his birth name, demonstrating that he was crowned as Tutankhamun. Oh, wait, sorry. Tutankhaten.
Yeah.
Between the death of Akhenaten and the ascent of Tutankhaten. That's a hard one. I'm so used to saying Tutankhaten. Tutankhaten.
Mm-hmm.
There was an interim pharaoh named Smenkarare.
About whom? What?
Smenkahakare.
We'll just say Smenkare. Yeah. We'll just do that.
Smenkahakare. Yeah.
All right.
About whom was little known. It's been suggested, however, since
Smenkare's.
There we go.
Smenkahakare's, bro.
Yeah. Throne name was identical to that of Akhenaten's. And that this pharaoh was Nefertiti, who ruled while Akhenaten's health may have been in decline, and Tutankhaten was still too young to assume the throne.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, essentially, Nefertiti ruled while Tut, before he was Tutankhamun, was Tutankhaten.
Yeah.
When he was too young, Nefertiti ruled.
Right. Yeah.
But she went under a different name.
Well, they gave him the rule, and then it was like, hold on, this makes no damn sense.
Nefertiti was
like, I got this, bro. Just chill back.
Right.
And then once he came of age, she just married him because that's weird.
Her son?
Stepson.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm having a hard time keeping all this.
It's hard to follow. Right? So Tut was like 8 or 9.
Yeah.
He ruled for like 2 or 3 years.
Right.
Nefertiti was like, this is stupid.
Uh-huh.
She ruled. And then once he came of
under
age.
Under a different name.
Under a different name. Mm-hmm. And then when he came of age to rule, she just married. He married her, I guess.
Like his who is his stepmother?
Yeah,
right.
I mean, there's a lot of hotel documentaries about that sort of activity. So I mean, it's not that outlandish, you know? It's not like that.
I mean, they started that shit back then.
Yeah, yeah. It's not unheard of. This is like the first Brazzers video, I think.
Yeah. So that's how thick it is, and that's how fucked up it is.
Yeah, that's what she was saying.
And that's why King Tut was so damn deformed.
Best
stepbrother ever, dude.
Yeah. Wow.
Step Pharaoh, what are you doing?
Jesus Christ. We're taking it there.
Man, if you don't know, now you know.
Last episode of season 2 is lit.
Yeah.
Anyway. Yeah, dude.
So one of the first things he did was return Egypt to the old religious practices, which his father had outlawed and suppressed, because his father doing all that shit seemed to really fuck some stuff up. So
yeah, it pissed everybody off.
Tut was like, let's go back to when it worked, pretty much. The Hittites during this time grew more powerful as he struggled to restore Egypt to its former glory and no longer having to fear intervention with the Egyptian military. Are you as dumb as me? Probably not, because I'm the most smartest. That's why I decided, not them, me, to use Anchor.fm for our podcast. It's been the most easiest way for us to do our thing.
Yvette.
Also, it's free, and we've established that I'm broke, right? Oh, no? Well, I am. And I bet you are, too, if you're thinking about starting a podcast. I bet you're so broke that you don't even have a custom-built home studio.
With your broke ass.
Doesn't matter, because Anchor FM works right off your phone or your computer. That's right. I know what you're thinking. Crazy Uber Ramblings podcast that you've been mulling around in your head for a little while now. It's possible.
Hey, guys, so where are we going today, guys?
Hey, can we go to that place, Pulaski, Tennessee, where the birthplace of,
No. Could you please exit my vehicle, sir? Thank you.
And something amazing like that will be immediately put out everywhere. Not only the biggies, but places you don't even know exist. Breaker, Overcast, Radio Public. What
the
even are those?
The fuck is that?
I don't know. Now, let's talk money. I know that gets your attention. You can make money with no minimum listenership, right? So let's think about Uncle Jimmy Ray.
I love it.
He loves it so much that Crazy Uber Ramblings, he starts paying a monthly subscription, and companies start paying you to talk about their shit. Now you're rolling in it. So are you the smartest and want to use a site that has all you need in one place? Then you should use Anchor.fm. That's Anchor.fm. Come on, dummy. Do it. The Hittites destroyed the kingdom of Mitanni, who had formerly been an ally of Egypt. Should be kept in mind that Tutankhamun at this time was about 16. And was tasked with the enormous responsibility of revitalizing the country his father had single-handedly devastated.
Mm-hmm.
Even with the help of elder councils who surrounded him, the teenage king must have found his position daunting. But still, he seems to have done his best to redeem the country's present from its recent past. What he might have accomplished in a longer reign will never be known, as he died before reaching the age of 20. The death of the young king has been called mysterious for centuries, but there's really no mystery involved. Many people died young in the ancient world, just as many do in the present day. The damage to Tutankhamun's skull, which they at first thought was proof that he was murdered, but it's probably more so the work of embalmers who removed the brain, just like
they fucked up
all mummies. Yeah, yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The injuries to the body of the skeleton are the result of its removal from the sarcophagus during the 1922 excavation, when the head was removed from the body and the skeleton was violently pried loose because it was stuck to the bottom of the sarcophagus.
Gross.
Yeah.
I like how all these European motherfuckers are like, bro, this shit's so dope. This dead ass body right here, bro. Yeah. Like, this shit's amazing, bro. Have you seen these bones wrapped in cloth and resin and shit? Mm. This is amazing. That's a dead person, bro. Cool. Uh-huh. Like, let it ride, dog.
And they crowbarred him out of his coffin because he was stuck to it with dead guy juice.
It's like,
so fucking weird.
It's like, so gross.
It won't go. Just pull harder. It still won't go. Pull harder. Crack. It seems like he may have been killed.
Yeah.
Why do you think that? I don't know. His leg's broken.
I think someone glued the bottom half of him to it, so it just be pulled and it stayed there.
You know, I think he might have been dead for a few thousand years.
Is the ultimate, is like,
it sticky. I don't know if it's a sticky.
It's just all, you're a little kid and you break a lamp and your mom gets home. You're like, what happened to the lamp? I'm like, I don't know. It's like that when I got here.
I got home.
Lamp is broke. I think somebody broke in and broke our lamp.
It may have been the vibrations off the school bus. I made
a sandwich. I turned around and shit was broke.
I might have closed my Bible too hard from studying and the shockwave knocked over the lamp.
It happens.
It's just amazing, happens every day. I don't know. I found it like that.
It's common day problems.
Yeah.
Spirit strong. Yeah. Mm. So, but it always surprises me.
Anyway. I know, right? That I personally think kind of dispels the infection from a broken leg is why he died. You know, some also think it could have been a tooth infection that was left untreated.
Yeah.
But another theory is that he was a product of an incestuous union.
You don't say.
What?
And so,
what? No.
He just he wasn't genetically disposed for a long time.
That's crazy.
Bro, he infamously had a club foot.
Yeah. And
could not walk properly. They have plenty of canes and walking sticks.
He's got a lot
in
of canes.
His fucking tomb.
Yeah.
But historians who support that theory point to the two children of Tutankhamun and Ankhsenumun, who were both stillborn. As physical evidence of the incestuous practices of Egyptian royalty of the 18th dynasty. Whether Akhenaten and Kia were related, however, is not known, and so this theory thus cannot be confirmed. All that is clearly known is that he died.
Shut up! Shut up!
You don't say. You don't say.
Oh my God.
We can confirm that. We can just go ahead and say that, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So King Tut is—he's not alive anymore.
No, exactly. No.
Okay, word. As long as we know that much.
Well, no, he's one of the past lives that live inside of Kanye West.
Oh yeah, because he embodies all of anything.
See, when Kanye's mother was pregnant with her, she drank the water of life, and that turned him into what's called an abomination.
Oh. God damn.
Oh, like shellfish.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
But
so he's a shrimp.
He could have been the Kwisatz Haderach, but
oyster. That's it.
I'll stop.
So,
you're going to do a Dune episode, right? And then I can tell you all that.
Okay, that'll be fun.
All right, great.
God.
It'll just be for us, though.
That's fine. That's fine.
See, I feel like this is a split off for a Dune podcast in our podcast network in the future.
Where it's just me and Grant talking about Dune.
Yeah.
So he
and
was
me not in the house at all.
So, King Tut. He's like we were saying earlier, he's super famous because of all the cool shit that they found in his tomb because nobody managed to steal it before.
Yeah.
That's why he's famous
because he had a bunch of shit left over.
Yeah. But one of the bigger aspects of it was how it was reported on, right? The headlines in 1922, Common Era, read The Mummy's Curse or The Curse of Tutankhamun. And that just amplified it as celebrity.
It's tight.
So this myth comes from a misinterpretation of an inscription found in the tomb that they thought read, "I will kill all of those who cross this threshold into the sacred precincts of the royal king who lives forever."
I'm going to put that on my front fucking door. I'm going to paint that.
Gangster.
That is going straight on the front door.
You got to mark your threshold. Okay?
Yeah. Don't come into my house. You're thinking about knocking, which is probably best that you don't.
Inside in here, please.
So surprise, surprise, that translation was wrong.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
White people were wrong.
Damn.
That's fucking
white
crazy.
White people were wrong trying to read ancient hieroglyphics. That's nuts.
Crazy. First and only time that white people were wrong. I can't even finish that.
Can't even finish that. Get up out of there, player.
Hit the button.
They're pretty sure that it actually reads, I am the one who prevents the sand from blocking the secret chamber.
Huh.
Which makes sense.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Which pretty much means that he's not going to get lost, you know, over time.
Yeah, but mm-hmm. like he did, though. And he's keeping a window up into for the spirits.
Yeah.
You know.
The curse myth spread quickly and seemed corroborated by an event which took place a few months after the tomb was opened. The English Lord Carnarvon, who ruled Carter's excavation, died, quote-unquote, mysteriously, just a few, almost a year to the day after it was discovered. And the international press seemed intent on ascribing his death to the tomb's opening and this ancient curse. After Carnarvon, the death of anyone who is in any way involved in opening the tomb was blamed on the curse. So that's why everybody knows the name King Tut.
Man, they fucked up that translation real good. That's like not
extremely
even,
well.
Not even like kind of right. I don't even think they got a similar word.
I think they were looking for it.
Yeah.
They were looking for
it. They wanted it to be spooky as hell.
Yeah. I wanted it to be fucked.
Which I get. I would. If I found a tomb, I'd want it to be spooky.
Hell yeah. See, I would never be in a position to find a tomb. So,
well, you know, that's
good,
I get
good
that.
On you.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm not saying if I. I'm not going.
You wouldn't have done that? If you were digging around in the sand in Egypt for some reason.
For fun.
Just for fun.
Just for fun.
Just if you find an entrance of a tomb, you're like, nope, not today.
You're just going to leave it alone?
Oh, if I tried a door and it didn't open, word, I'm not supposed to be in it.
They locked it for a reason.
Obviously, that's cool.
What a healthy way to view the world.
Yeah.
Not supposed to be in there. God. Word.
For some reason, that seems like it comes off of trial and error.
Like, huh, not supposed to be there. Moving on with my life. Damn, there's a cat person over here. Yeah. That's wild.
I'm going to go follow
Let's go look
for
at
a
that.
While.
Let's go look at that. Like, fuck. Anyway, yeah, it's not in my not in my genetic code, if you will.
That's super.
The unknown.
That's super in ours. Yeah. Yes, like, here's a locked door where we're not supposed to be. Let's get a fucking sledgehammer and bust it down. Yeah.
What are they having?
What are they got
going on?
Man, I bet they got some cool shit in there.
What is that really strange sound I never heard before? Let's go investigate.
Yeah, let's go check
it
out.
Bro. Yeah, no. Let's go to where that sound is not coming from. And avoid said thing that's making sound.
Oh.
But, yeah, that's just genetic difference there. And we're going to slide up in Cleopatra.
Coming at you.
I would
facts.
Love to.
Yeah, right?
Would you?
I'll tell you what.
I just, anytime I think of Cleopatra, I just imagine incredible cleavage. I don't know where, why that's the
you know, that's like we talked about in the, you know, last episode. If you believe it's a fact, then it's a fact for you.
Yeah. So I'm not saying they were big. But I bet they're just like
they were nice.
Beautiful.
It's good shape. Yeah.
Nice spacing in between.
I bet she was more of a vibe.
She, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Like, I bet like her presence was just like kind of like
I mean, it
more so than people like saying like she was like a striking and like all this. It's like her presence was just like very visceral. Like she's here. Like
her presence.
Shit.
Yeah,
was your present.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Her dad was King Ptolemy the 12th.
Cool.
King, and as that being said, she was obviously destined to become the last queen of the Macedonian dynasty.
Yeah.
That ruled Egypt between the death of Alexander the Great in 323 and its annexation by Rome in 30. Yeah. I'm sorry you guys can't understand
BCE,
my pronunciation.
No, I got
BCE.
It.
You know?
No.
Jesus Christ.
Right,
it's been
you.
Going on for an hour.
We didn't.
Don't worry about it.
You didn't have to explain.
Yep. We're not.
I'm explaining it to you.
I don't know why you're coming to me all intense like this.
It's
because of my spot on King Ramsay's impersonation.
Sexy ass beard.
Yeah, I get it. I get that.
That's young Socrates over there, kid.
It is. What's up? I know.
What's up?
The line was started by Alexander's general Ptolemy. He was named King Ptolemy the First, Soter of Egypt.
Mm, that's cool.
Yeah. Cleopatra was of Macedonian descent and had little, if any, Egyptian blood, contrary to popular belief.
Yeah, I had no idea.
Yeah. It's pretty wild, Egyptians did not like her.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, well, they didn't because...
she wasn't them.
The Ptolemaic Empire that controlled for the last 300 years that she was the last and part of, they didn't even see it fit to learn like the Egyptian language.
Yeah, yeah.
They were just like, no.
They spoke Greek.
Peasants. Yeah.
They spoke Greek,
that's,
right?
And that's why.
Rude. Yeah.
That's wild, man.
Yeah, the ruling class being rude.
I know.
Weird. Isn't that weird?
It is weird.
It's so well, strange. I mean... Like I'm about to say with the whole Egyptian blood or not having Egyptian blood, the classical author Plutarch wrote that she alone of her house took the trouble to learn Egyptian and for political reasons styled herself as the new Isis, a title that distinguished her from the earlier Ptolemaic queen Cleopatra III because she's Cleopatra VII.
The seventh?
Yeah. But history knows her as Cleopatra. Because the other ones like didn't really.
They didn't learn Egyptian.
Yeah, right.
Nor model themselves after one of their gods.
They didn't seduce.
They didn't have the power of persuasion.
Yeah. They didn't do that thing persuasion. With their hips that she did. That
she was super fucking smart. Like, she was educated.
She was intelligent and she was manipulative.
She was. Well,
she didn't fuck
a
lot like people think.
She was. Well, I mean, that's the thing that you run into dangers with.
She didn't fuck how people think she fucked.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You run into dangers when you have the power of education combined with manipulation.
Mm-hmm.
And
also being a woman with basically the powers
of... Well, that ain't nice. I resemble that remark.
When you're a woman coming from a matriarchal ideologically. Boom. And you get studied by a patriarch.
Yeah.
Of course, it's going to turn from like, this wasn't just a great ruler with intelligence and the intent to manipulate and get power. It was,
she was a
woman trying to take advantage. And she was like,
how the hell did this lady do that?
Taking hearts. Yeah, exactly.
Is it okay that if I objectify someone who's been dead for over 2,000 years?
Sure.
Okay, I think it's okay.
Cool. And I do it respectfully.
We'll give you a PC pass.
Okay, thank you.
PCP.
Because I think she's awesome.
Well,
I like that.
I think she's awesome.
I think she's awesome.
That was your objectification?
No. I've been talking about her butt for like the whole time. But I also think she's awesome.
I'm sure she had a nice butt.
That's good.
It's good.
Getting back to the whole aspect of everybody she's just beautiful and portrayed herself even in that time as being this beautiful person and that's how she got her way. Or, you know, the coin portraits of her is what the only thing that we really have. Mm-hmm. And after scholars have really looked into this, they found that she essentially took the coin of Caesar of the time and her dad's nose. That's why her nose is so prominent. And she's wearing a olive wreath.
Mm-hmm.
She really didn't care about being a beautiful person. She wanted to present herself as powerful because she knew that if she presented herself as this sex object, as history looks at her as
advantage,
that she would be taken advantage of.
Yeah, exactly.
She just used sex sometimes to take advantage of
she,
them.
She manipulated so many people with the idea of them falling in love with her.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, bro, like she did do that for sure.
Okay. So when her dad died in 51 BCE, the throne passed to his young son, Ptolemy the 13th, and daughter, Cleopatra.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, and it's likely that the two married, like right after their dad died, which is kind of
who married
fucked up Cleopatra and her little brother.
Yeah. That's what I thought you said.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And the thing is that she's like
10 years old.
She's 18 at this point. Okay. And her brother is 8 years younger than her.
Yeah.
It's easily to see that this this type of activity went all the way into European culture after the Greeks and Romans came.
Especially the British culture.
Yeah.
And they flew. You know what I mean?
Well, we only had like 4 major countries there. So that's like. Gotta marry somebody.
Roman South, Roman East, Roman West, Roman North.
I meant like in. European
era.
You got France, Germany, Spain, England.
So, so post Roman Empire. All right.
Seaway.
Anyway.
Yeah.
The 18-year-old Cleopatra, older than her brother by 8 years,
Look at that.
Became the overall ruler. Wonder why?
Because he was 10 years old and she probably wanted to kill his ass anyway.
Yeah, right. It's
fucking gross. Evidence shows that the first decree in Ptolemy's name precedes Cleopatra's, which precedes Cleopatra's, was in October of 50 BCE. Soon after, Cleopatra was forced to flee Egypt for Syria, where she raised an army and in 48 returned to face her brother in Pelusium on Egypt's eastern border. So, yeah, she... as soon as people got word that it was a chick ruling over stuff, and it wasn't him, they were like, and he had to be forced to make his first decree of like, you gotta go. I know you're my sister wife.
They made him break up with his sister wife.
Yeah,
that's sad.
Yeah,
his 10 year older sister wife.
Oh, but there's peace to be brought for just temporarily.
Oh, good. Tell me about it.
So. The murder of the Roman general Pompey and the arrival of...
Pompey?
No, Pompey. Pompey is the volcanic... The place.
There was a Governor Pompey.
Mm-hmm. You were a Governor Pompey.
Yeah.
Anyway, and the arrival of Julius Caesar was the only thing that brought like a little bit of peace.
Yeah.
Cleopatra realized she needed Roman support, or more significantly, Caesar's support. If she was going to regain the throne, obviously.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Both were determined to use each other.
In obviously. So many ways.
Right.
Just over and over and over.
Jesus Christ.
You guys talking about sex?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Not at all.
Gross. Okay. No. Get your heads out of the gutters.
Dude, touching butts, man.
So Caesar wanted money for repayment of the debts incurred by Cleopatra's father. Cleopatra was determined to keep her throne and, if possible, restore the lands that were lost in the Ptolemaic era, which was southern Syria and Palestine. Caesar and Cleopatra became lovers and spent the winter shacked up in Alexandria.
Nice.
Yeah, dog.
Yeah. But Roman reinforcements arrived the following spring. Ptolemy XIII fled and drowned in the Nile.
Huh. So wait. Idiot. Let's just go back real quick.
Tripped and hit his head, or?
I guess. Oxyrhynchus done grabbed his dinkus.
Yeah.
Oxyrhynchus. Oxyrhynchus.
There's a lot of hippos in there, man.
That's true. That's a good point.
Hippos.
Electric catfish, dude. I was using chicken liver, man.
Crocodiles and shit.
Hippos are like the most violent animal.
Yeah. Super, super serious.
Yeah, they are.
They're not very nice.
So Caesar and Cleopatra created cuffing season.
Do what?
They created cuffing season. They shacked up for the wintertime, right? It's cuffing season.
Yeah, for sure.
Come on, man.
I feel like it's been around for a long time.
I'm looking at facts. Yeah, Caesar and Cleopatra, that's a long time ago, bro. Like, fuck you, mean?
Well, obviously, they did this, but Cleopatra, anyway. Because her brother, Ptolemy the 13th, just died, in succession is married to her brother, Ptolemy the 14th. After she just shacked up with Caesar.
Oh, I've been thinking they were the same brother this whole time.
No.
Okay, so is it little brother that kicked her out of Egypt, or is it older brother?
Little brother kicked her out.
But she's married to other little brother.
Well, now, because other little brother's, little brother's dead. So
she married both her brothers?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, she probably married a few of them. Yeah. She married two of her brothers.
Man, she's making it real hard for me to love her.
Yeah, well, you know, I told you, the plot thickens.
It does, it does. Thickens like the Dickens.
So, Ptolemy, the 14th, now married to Cleopatra.
Okay.
You know, so two. Cleopatra, you know, it restored her to her throne, though, in doing that.
Yeah.
In June of 47, she gave birth to Ptolemy Caesar, known to the people of Alexandria as Caesarion, or Little Caesar.
Pizza.
Hey! Yeah!
Oh, it hadn't been good since the 90s. Let's go.
Whether Caesar was the actual father of Caesarion,
it's like fine.
As his name implies, isn't really certain, but sure.
You know.
Pizza. That's all I needed to hear. Yeah. It took Caesar 2 years to resolve the Pompeian opposition that he was dealing with before. As soon as he returns to Rome in 46 BCE, he celebrated a 4-day triumph, ceremonial in honor
Hanoi.
Honor. No, but the ceremony in honor of a general after his victory over a foreign enemy, in which Arsinoe, Cleopatra's younger and more hostile sister, was paraded around. So okay. He essentially just came back and honored his victory with Cleopatra's sister dancing in the streets.
Mm-hmm. You know what? I bet he just grabbed the wrong sister and didn't even realize.
He may have.
Yeah, maybe
yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Yeah.
I like how they describe her as hostile.
Well,
more hostile.
More hostile than yeah. Cleopatra.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Cleopatra was maybe obviously a little bit
smarter.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah,
probably meant she was more intelligent and probably less flagrant.
Demure.
Vivacious.
So Cleopatra paid at least one visit, you know, to her state in Rome, accompanied by her husband, brother, and son. Husband, brother. Not husband.
I was like brother, there's no brother. Son involved, too.
Not husband, like, no. Husband, but husband, brother.
Husband, brother, yeah. And their son.
And their son.
And then their son. Okay.
Yeah, pizza, yes. Pizza.
Yeah, yeah, pizza, pizza.
Pizza, pizza. Was,
oh, yeah, that guy.
That's probably.
Yeah. 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 I like thinking they dressed like that, too. Like, he just had, like, that weird, like, little, like, lion, was it toga, and then just walked around with a spear.
Uh-huh.
That's why the only thing that he says is pizza, pizza.
Yeah.
Because... Yeah. He's an inbred child.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's all he can say.
It's all he can say.
Is pizza, pizza.
That's not even a thing yet.
It's kind of like a bam,
what
bam,
are you? You know? What are you saying to me? Pizza, 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 pizza. It's like, little Caesar. That's not a word. Are you hungry? Pizza, 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 pizza. And he's like literally just like an egg-shaped man with like little arms and legs.
Man, the irony of us eating pizza today. Jesus. Anyway.
Okay, so... Her paying that, you know, trip to Rome involved seeing Caesar being murdered.
It's a bummer.
So mm-hmm. She kind of dipped out in yeah. a fleeing attempt to not be
also turbo stabbed.
Yeah. Right. But so she went back to Alexandria. Mm-hmm. And soon after her return to Alexandria in 44 BCE, Ptolemy... The 1400th died.
Her other brother husband died.
Why she? Her actual brother husband at the time.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was the 14th.
Yeah.
So Ptolemy the 14th died. The next brother under her died. And so now Cleopatra rules with her infant son.
Yes, exactly. Yes.
Yes.
Ptolemy the 15th Caesar.
Yeah,
is what
yeah.
it says.
Pizza, pizza.
Yeah.
Do you want to rule all of Egypt?
Pizza, 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 pizza. Oh, Jesus Christ.
What do you think we should do with the traitors?
Pizza, pizza.
Yes, I agree.
Put them on a spike.
Yep, we should put them on a spike in Town Square. Pizza, pizza.
With pepperoni, pizza, pizza. Yes. Pizza, pizza. Yes. Yes. Extra that. Cheese. Oh, my God. Jesus. Whoa.
Are you hungry, little Caesar? No, we had that last night. Fine. All
right. Lobster.
Lobster.
He is Groot.
Anyway. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So fast forward to the Battle of Philippi. Caesar's assassins were routed. Mark Antony became their heir. He just kind of took the throne from him. Or yeah. so it seemed.
Or so it seemed.
Or so it seemed. Antony, now controller of Rome's eastern territories, sent for Cleopatra. Wonder why. So that she could explain her role in the aftermath of Caesar's assassination. Why were you here when Caesar was assassinated?
Yeah.
You know, kind of a deal. She showed up and gave her explanation. All was balked.
Yeah.
There was no, you know, no. disdain with anything that she said. And after that, she set out for Tarsus in Asia Minor, the Hittites area. Loaded with gifts, having delayed her departure to heighten Antony's expectations. So, like, he was waiting there for her after that because he was just like, hey, what the fuck? You were here. Caesar died. I've got this shit to go take care of. He moves up there to go meet with them and says, hey, meet me here.
Yeah.
Bringing gifts and stuff so we can set up a trade route. Well, she shows up and she's got this boat just decked out with palm trees and gifts, and she's got the, you know, the head of Isis on and everything, and just
robes
shows up
and all that shit.
Yeah, you know, right.
Of new and Isis.
So her pulling up into the Cydnus River
and showing up with this like elaborate affair that she showed up with just super enthralled him, because he was just like, oh, okay, yeah, she said she's going to be here. Well, she shows up a little late. I got a little anticipation. She shows up in just like roaring enamored, you know, like mm-hmm. she
yeah,
is
yeah,
just
yeah, yeah, yeah.
like, okay, holy shit. So after this, it made him forget about his wife, Fulvia.
Wait, what's her name?
Fulvia.
Like,
anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, but anyway, it made him forget, it made him forget about his wife, who was actually in Italy trying to keep him interested in the growing threat of Octavian.
Ah.
But he wasn't really, you know, paying too much attention. So Antony returned to Alexandria, where he treated Cleopatra not as a protected sovereign, but as an independent monarch.
Mm-hmm. I don't think he's supposed to do that.
Oh, especially. Mm. Especially when you married and got stuff going on at home. Oh. And she trying to stand by her man and ain't happening.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. That happened, son. Bro.
That was the thing I experienced.
Justin, it's going to be okay, baby girl. Anyway, meanwhile, in Alexandria, Cleopatra and Antony formed a society whose members lived somewhat with what some historians have interpreted as a life of debauchery and folly. Yeah.
Damn right. Sounds like my people.
That sounds awesome, man.
Yeah. And the people who didn't, you know, describe it as that just described it as like a sacrifice to Dionysus.
Yeah.
Which is essentially what they were trying to do in the first place. In 40 BCE, Cleopatra gave birth to two twins who she named Alexander Helios and Cleopatra Selene. Mm. Antony had already left Alexandria to return to Italy at this point, where he was forced to conclude a temporary settlement with Octavian again. Here's that cut. As part of this settlement, he married Octavia's sister, Octavia.
Mm.
3 years later, Antony figured out that this shit wasn't working because there was nothing coming out of this marriage.
Exactly.
She was the worst in Rome. Octavia, yeah. She was so annoying.
Yeah, so he figured out it was irrelevant for him to be even in that, so he just reunited with Cleopatra.
Okay, so I'm gonna need a little recap just for myself. Mm-hmm. So Anthony's like, "Hey, Cleopatra, come explain yourself," and mm-hmm. then she shows up fashionably late,
mm-hmm.
extra fashionable.
Yeah. Yeah. With a bunch of
emphasis
stuff.
On the fashion.
Yeah, right. On the fashion. And then he falls in love with her, forgetting about his wife in Italy.
Yeah.
Fulvia.
Yeah.
They get to knocking boots.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
She pops out some twins.
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes back to deal with his actual job.
Yeah.
And kind of deals with that, but then ends and his up boss marrying is like,
hey,
the
sister. You gotta marry my sister now.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then he's like, this is lukewarm at best or whatever. So he's now going to go back over to Cleopatra.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, he's also dependent on Cleopatra for that said trade that they tried to create.
Antony needed Cleopatra's financial support for his postponed Parthian campaign. In return, Cleopatra's request was to return much of Egypt's empire back to what they had lost, which was Syria, Lebanon, and even a little bit of the groves of Jericho.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So she was wanting to use him for land. He was wanting to use her to pay her father back, essentially.
Yeah, pretty much. It was kind of like, hey, you give me some money to support my political shit, I'll give you power to support your political shit.
Yeah.
And we'll call it even.
Well, the Parthian campaign was actually a costly failure.
Mm-hmm.
As was the temporary conquest of Armenia. Although in 34 BCE, Antony celebrated a triumphal return to Alexandria. This was followed by a celebration known as the Donations of Alexandria. It's where crowds flocked to the gymnasiums to see Cleopatra and Antony just seated up above everybody and looking nice, kind of a deal.
Yeah.
You know. Antony proclaimed Caesarion, little Caesar, to be Caesar's son, thus relegating Octavian, who had been adopted by Caesar, and his son and heir, to the legal illegitimacy. Huh. Yeah.
Huh.
So, little Caesar's emperor now?
Pizza.
Uh-huh.
It sounds like he's constipated.
Like, do you want to run Rome?
Little Caesar. Jesus Christ. Well, so at this point, Cleopatra is held as the Queen of Kings. Tight. And Caesarion is held as king of kings. So she is still head of everything, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Alexander Helios was awarded Armenia and the territory beyond the Euphrates. His infant brother Ptolemy, the lands, another Ptolemy, probably the 15th.
Yeah.
Well, no, it'd be like 16th at this point. Yeah. Ptolemy, the lands of the west of the Euphrates. The boy's sister, Cleopatra Selene, was to be the ruler of Cyrene.
Huh. Cool.
Yeah.
Selene of Cyrene, so, you don't say.
Little Caesar is king of kings.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
It's like, are you my little king of kings?
Anyway, it was clear to Octavian that Antony intended to extend, like, to put his extended family in as the ruling class. Mm. This resulted in a propaganda war.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, Octavian seized Antony's will, or claimed that it was his will, from the temples of the Vestal Virgins.
Nice.
The VVs.
To whom it had been entrusted at the time, yeah. And revealed the Roman people, revealed to the Roman people that not only had Antony bestowed Roman possessions on foreign women, but intended to be buried beside her in Egypt, which is a little weird. Rumor quickly spread that Antony also intended to transfer the capital from Rome to Alexandria, which... Yeah. Also, chap some asses.
Yeah, a lot of asses.
Seems not true.
Mm.
Yeah. Weird, right?
Man.
Seems not true. Yeah. Sounds like a Saturday Night Live character. That was pretty great. Antony and Cleopatra spent the winter of 32 and 31 BCE in Greece.
Wonder what they was doing.
The Roman Senate deprived Antony of his prospective consulate for the following year, and it then declared war against Cleopatra. Mm. So they were like, okay, so Antony, you can't have shit for a year, and Cleopatra, we're going to declare war on you and everything you
separate, divide, and conquer. Take them apart because they're fucking a lot of shit up, obviously.
Separate
them and then conquer them on their, in their own turf and land. Vibes, things.
So, stuff. Which leads us to the naval battle of Actium. This happened in 31 BCE and was a disaster for the Egyptians because even with Antony and Cleopatra on both sides, Octavian had a little bit of a trick up his sleeve. Antony and Cleopatra had to flee Egypt. Cleopatra retired to her mausoleum, or what was the name of that style tomb? The M-word?
Mastaba.
Yeah.
That's what that barber guy had.
So she just sent back. She just went back and chilled in her tomb area.
Mastaba. Yeah.
Which was kind of crazy.
Her tomb is being constructed for her. She's just going to go chill in that.
Yeah.
Nobody can come there.
Yeah. And
it's already built for her. So
And while she did that, Antony went off to fight his last battle. Fast forward to receiving false news that Cleopatra had died. Mm-hmm. Antony fell on his sword.
Yeah.
In the last excess of devotion. He had himself carried to Cleopatra's retreat and then there died after bidding her to make her peace with Octavian. So he hears homegirl's dead. Falls on his sword, drags himself or has someone drag him back to her villa. And sees her and goes, oh, shit, she ain't dead. Please just make peace with this motherfucker and dies.
That's the ultimate betrayal.
What a punk way to go out, man.
Right?
What a bummer.
Killed yourself because you thought somebody was dead and they're not dead.
Well, and then Cleopatra buried Antony and then committed suicide.
Turn up.
Seems unnecessary.
Seems a little excessive. Seems
Romeo but it's almost Juliet. Like it's like that backwards Romeo and Juliet almost.
Yeah, for sure. And also, she knew without Antony's backing, she had no military support.
Right, right.
Really, you know what I'm saying?
Well, yeah, and you know, there's no real knowledge of how she actually died. Although a lot of scholars, you know, there's the whole like the asp, which is part of the name of this episode, which is a snake that will kill your ass.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah, they're really good at it.
She dealt with a lot of poisons, being super educated and being a botanist and other things that a lot of people and historians, well, not historians, but normal folk look over and aren't educated on. She dealt with poisons a lot and probably worked on this for a while and knew what the fuck she was doing.
There was a lot of mysterious deaths in Egypt.
But and she just families. So happened to just... You know? fall over and die, yeah. You know, and it was, I don't know.
She essentially hid her identity and been alive.
She knew what was coming down, and she knew that it was the fall of this empire, and she poisoned herself. And that's what all fingers point to. But I mean, it could be the asp, but yeah. She still poisoned herself. She got it to bite her, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah,
it's just like Nefertiti. You know, they say that either she got killed or committed suicide, but also she just disappeared from the books. Mm-hmm. So she could affect her death
because she
ended up in Asia as well.
Which Nefertiti? Ramesses,
Nefertiti, or Nefertiti?
Nefertiti, which is
Nefertiti.
Tut's
girl.
Stepmom.
Yeah.
And that I think became his girl. Wife.
Yeah. Yes. Step Pharaoh, what are you doing?
Oh, no, Step. You're the best Step Pharaoh ever.
Step Pharaoh, come help me. I'm trapped in the sarcophagus.
My God.
No, Step Pharaoh, what are you doing?
Step Pharaoh, I'm stuck in the dishwasher.
All right, enough hotel documentary recalls. You guys need to clear your fucking search histories.
Incognito, baby.
Weirdos. Anyway, so yeah, that is that brings us to the end of the Egyptian series and the dynasty. After that, wow. They pretty much just faded off.
What happened to Little Caesar?
Pizza.
Bro, he's all around America. He made his way to America.
He made his way to America and had good pizza until like 96-ish.
It's like
and then
fine.
It just dropped off. No, it's he had good pizza at 96-ish. Yeah. Like that pizza used to be like delicious.
Detroit style pizza, whatever the fuck that
well,
means.
Well, now yeah, it's cardboard style pizza. So
It followed Detroit's goodness.
Apparently. It says it on the box. It says Detroit style pizza. It says it right there on the box. You look at it.
It's true. Hot facts from the kid.
All right.
Also, hope y'all enjoyed this edutainment. It was a little loose.
A lot of loose.
A little off the rails. Well, but it's right. We made it through season 2 and we made it through 2020. And we about to be back with these hot facts in the year 2021. Actually, this is probably coming out in 2021. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so we're coming back soon with season 3. Hope y'all enjoyed all the content so far. If any of these facts you feel are false, or if we said some things wrong, or if you were offended at all, or if you loved it, you can always just email us at friends.facts.fiction@gmail.com. And those periods are just dots, okay? You don't have to type the word period. And also, you can you can support us.
And if you
us.
Do, stop listening to our podcast.
And you also can support us at anchor.fm/friendsfactsandfiction. You can subscribe and help us out. Is greatly appreciated. We love everybody that listens, everybody that supports us. We love you all from all around the world. Our listenership is very broad, is very the numbers are okay, but the reach is wide. And we love you all and happy you got through last year if you're still listening. And you know, it's been fun. It's been exciting, and this podcast has literally saved my life mentally and emotionally. And I want to thank Drew Shonut and Grant Bramlett for
thank you, sir.
Fucking sticking here with me when us doing this shit together. And it's been a beautiful fucking experience. I'm happy that everybody enjoys it and everybody that texts me or calls me and emails us. I'm happy that y'all enjoy it as well. And I want to thank Sam Capasso for being here with us.
Yeah, of
course.
Stay
on me.
Had a great time.
Sam Capasso is out here in
we
the building.
We had a great time with you.
You can go get a fresh-ass cut from him here in Nashville at...
Monty's Barbershop in the Arcade.
Boom.
You can book online at montysbarbershop.com.
Bang, bang.
He's very good at it.
If you're ever through the city, hit the homie up. We out here in the city
of Nashville. If you're really loving those haircuts, too, you can Facebook fund me to go get one. And Drew Shelnut.
He's looking scraggly.
I look like my fucking dad right now, guys.
It's all right, man. Embrace that shit, homie. But that's my end of the year wrap up. I'm Justin Ammons, and I'm saying love, live life, because it's worth living, y'all.
And I'm Drew Shelnut, and I'm saying, honestly, inform yourself, and you will make a difference.
There we go.
Damn.
Facts. Before I do my sign off, I do want to say when we're getting ready for season 3, I'm going to put out a couple of little fun short boys. So if anybody has any ideas for those, just shoot them our way.
It means short episodes, by the way. Just
yeah.
Chucking
yeah. No, we've got a couple friends with kids, and they're short boys. So we're just gonna take pictures of them.
Yeah. put them out somewhere.
We're just gonna put some kids outside and just see what happens.
That's exactly right. That's
so really
exactly
fun.
We're gonna put out some short episodes in between now and season 3, and a rebrand is coming as well. But continue, guys.
Rebranding
for sure.
Yeah, you know, new pictures, new
pictures, new sample.
Oh, cool.
Be aware. Simple change is going to be the same podcast.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Do you think
somebody's getting fired? But you know, they'll find that out later. but anyways.
God damn it! I'm the bass player.
thanks for listening to all of us talking all stupid, because there's now several hours of it, and if you still listen on a weekly basis, it's just awesome. And keep doing it, and then tell all your friends. And I never liked you, but I did always love you.
Hey,
it's beautiful.
I love you guys, and you have just the best dude here. Good shit. Bill just retired your stuff.
I know Ramesses was here.
Thanks.
Just to Fedro Ramesses. Just come to my Ramsey theater and watch my Ramsey movies and get the Ramsey corn. Okay. I'm just going to go to nap now.
Going to go do a Ramsey nap?
Don't do a Ramsey nap.
Yeah.
Do you got to sign off, my guy?
I think that was it.
Thank you all for having me on. I had a great time, and hope everyone has a wonderful new year and a great 2021.
There you go. Bang, bang, boom, boom. This has been a podcast called Friends, Facts, and Fiction. We out.
Thanks for listening, and stay tuned for the next episode. Find us on Facebook and Instagram to stay up to date on everything Friends, Facts, and Fiction. Our Instagram handle is friends_facts_fiction. As always, please reach out to us. You can send any of your questions, praise, and fact-checking to friends.facts.fiction@gmail.com. It's important to us to only propagate the truth, and we will correct any errors we may have made. This has been a production of Friends, Facts, and Fiction.